There is no sign or any other clue that would make one think that this ordinary looking hole in the ground near a beach in Crimea could be an extremely important historic site. It's a stone quarry, a historic stone quarry in which the stones have been cut from the bedrock using a technology that far surpasses our so-called modern equipment. It is obvious that large chunks of stone have been quarried, taken away. But how did they separate them from the bedrock? This is how we do it in our supposedly modern quarries. And these monster stone-cutting machines leave this type of tool marks behind themselves. Vladimir visits a modern stone quarry in this very same region where absolutely same type of stone has been quarried. The monster stone cutting machines leave serious marks behind, 12 centimeters wide in this case, although the stone that has been cut off is much smaller than the chunks that have been quarried in the historic quarry that we saw earlier. The marks left by the teeth of the monster machine are very clearly visible. The walls of the historic beach quarry are radically different. The width of the cutting is some 3-4 millimeters only. The slices of stone were large, some 1, 2, or even more meters long. No doubt, we do have thin discs for cutting stone nowadays that would leave that thin marks behind. However, their diameter is far less than a couple of meters. They are used by jewelers, not in stone quarries. If we manufacture discs with a large diameter and such a thickness, just 2-3 millimeters, they will break after 1 or 2 seconds of workload. Even lightweight, portable stone cutting equipment has blades that are much thicker than 2-3 millimeters. And here is an easy example for non-specialists. Imagine just a simple chainsaw for cutting wood. Wood is much softer material than stone. And still, if you imagine you cut something much harder with your wood chainsaw, still the marks will be much bigger and much rougher than those seen in the historic beach quarry. And just imagine what kind of rough, monstrous marks would leave this type of thing. There are other techniques for cutting stone, like for example, this is a wire saw. It cuts stone with a diamond wire. But all of them, without an exception, share the same disadvantages. It either leaves two mark that is much wider than the ancient one, or the cuttings that it can produce are way smaller than those seen in the historic quarry. This is a water jet cutting technology. It can definitely produce smooth cuttings like those in the historic quarry, but the scale would be pathetically dwarfish compared to the old stuff. The depth of the historic cuttings vary. The depth is not uniform throughout the full cutting, which is yet another proof that it was not done with some sort of disc instrument. Gradually and slowly changing depth of the cuttings would have been observed in case a huge disc was used. But that is not the case. The depth changes constantly and quickly. And not only it is very narrow, marks of any hard tool being used on the stone are absolutely absent throughout the quarry. One is left with the impression that as if a beam of energy simply disintegrated the stone. The cuttings that are now observed on the walls are just the casual leftovers of the actual cutting. The actual cutting was much more than these 20, 30 centimeters that they overcut. Apparently, making such cuttings was a rather easy task for them, and that is why they didn't care if they cut 30, 40 centimeters extra. This wouldn't be the case in a modern stone quarry because that would lead to enormous wastage of resources and energy. For example, the stone that was removed from this particular spot was about a meter wide and much more than 1 meter high. The height cannot be measured at this point because of the thick layer of rubble and dust on the floor. The extra cutting goes more than 30 centimeters deep into the bedrock. And still, it is only 3-4 millimeters wide. Now let's return to the modern quarry and see with our own eyes how primitive it looks compared to the old stuff.
Thank you.
Modern setup that would do the job. But what about the historic quarry? What kind of technique did they use? My history teacher at school told me that this was the frontier technology in old times. But when I look at the elegant and precise cuttings on the wall of the old quarry, they don't seem like a work of mule riders. There are no remains of any transportation system, at least not visible ones. Well, even the floor is not visible as such. It is almost completely covered. But yet, at few spots, it is still visible. And it doesn't really at all look suitable for any sort of railway-like transportation because of the steps. Since the cutting technique is so elegant, maybe the transportation technique was elegant as well. Our planet is full of megaliths. Many of them are made of truly gigantic stones that our so-called modern equipment can handle with great difficulty or cannot handle at all. My teacher at school told me that the poor ancient people suffered dragging such enormous stones, led by some sort of naive belief that the bigger the stones, the more the gods will be pleased with them. She heard it from the big scientists. Those sit in very expensive leather chairs, and when they talk, everybody must believe them, because they speak with such a confidence as if they have seen the mule riders with their own eyes. I think that the ancient stone builders used such huge stone blocks simply because it was very easy for them. For us, it is some sort of nightmare to handle such heavy stones, but that doesn't mean that they had the same problem. But some people prefer to stick to the fairy tale of the mule riders no matter what. A very good example is an email I received. Quote, a perspective on the Great Pyramid and other voluminous projects. I personally can move 10 yards or 20,000 pounds of loose material per day in a wheelbarrow. It would take me 2,500 years to move that volume, means of the pyramid, but I don't need to worry about. 5,000 guys could shift that volume over and up probably within 3 years, taking into account the laziness and holidays. Tossing the equation, fine Egyptian beer at the top of the ramp, with barmaids alternating with disappointed grandfathers, and that schedule would be easily met, if not beaten, by many months. Well, I say, why just wheelbarrows? Why not put them on bicycles even? All those tiny megaliths slash feathers, But specifically for people who think along those lines, and that the mermaids could have built the Great Pyramid, I'll give few additional proofs that this beach quarry is indeed a historic site. The high-tech cutting marks are enough proof themselves, but some people have difficulty grasping such things. And especially for them, I will provide a bit of clarification. First of all, there are no remains of any sort of industrial setup anywhere around the quarry. If this was an abandoned, modern quarry, there should have been at least some minor traces of the full setup. It doesn't evaporate so fast. There isn't anything like this around. It is just a hole in the ground. Out there in the fields near the beach. Next, there are colonies of very well-fed bats inside the quarry, and those colonies don't just land there from somewhere else, they develop with time. It takes long time. The presence of the bats by itself proves that these quarries have been abandoned and vacant for a very long time. Graffiti are found in great abundance in this quarry. Most of them belong to the 20th century. It seems that in the 40s, the graffiti artists were particularly prolific because many of the dates point to that time period. In addition, erosion can be observed on some of the walls that have cuttings on them. This type of erosion shows clearly that partially that the bottom part of the wall was either underwater or it was buried under debris for a prolonged period of time. This type of erosion doesn't develop just in a couple of years. The floor is covered, at least at the location, the only location that they tried to dig at, was covered with a very thick layer of powdered stone, maybe some 40 centimeters. Did it all fall from the ceiling, or was the stone quarried meant to be powdered to make a geopolymer, or is the powder just a byproduct of the cutting that was used, that was decomposing the stone, apparently? Actually, at this point, we know very, very little about our true history. That is why I'm calling for experienced remote viewers and past life regressionists who would like to contribute. To volunteer in the project of making at least a basic timeline of our true history. Few other locations in the vicinity also look like as if they have been part of a quarrying project. They are in the open, they are not in the ground. They also display clear signs of erosion. The blocks that have been quarried must have been of really megalithic proportions, and still we see the same very fine cuttings of just 4 millimeters, 3 or 4. Besides erosion, we again see graffiti from the 40s on the quarried walls, and again no hint of any sort of industrial setup that could have transported these megalithic blocks from the location, in case somebody still doubts that these are some abandoned modern quarries. For those who wish to study the historic techniques of quarrying stone, probably the area of Sevastopol is the best spot on Earth to be. What I have been calling historic quarry so far probably belongs to an ancient civilization. That's one. Number two is the modern quarry that I showed you, and that is only the beginning. It seems that two other historic civilizations have left their hallmarks in the area as well. Next, we will visit, together with Vladimir, the so-called Inkerman historic quarries. Well, they could have been quarries, but they surely are very large cavities. Large amounts of stone have been removed from the site in the past. On the top, there are some signs of erosion. They consist of at least a dozen of such large cavities in the bedrock. There has been no quarry at this location during the known history. That's why they're considered prehistoric. Everything seems to be okay so far in the story. Just this small detail that this is how the prehistoric man looked like according to the history textbooks. And on the walls of the Inkerman quarries, we see machine tool marks left by this type of equipment. Everything else, besides this minor discrepancy, appears to be fine.
Thank you. средневековье для каких-то хозяйственных. Отчетливо все в следах осколков.
То есть здесь...
Кровопролитнейшая битва была за каждую высоту.
This stonework appears to be very similar, if not identical, to the stonework in the Chinese underground quarries or caves that I commented on in the episode of the survivors devoted to China. A different type of equipment or a different mining technique appears to have been used exactly below the ceiling. I think that the reason for this is that they used a different tool to make the initial penetration in the solid stone, and then when they had a room for the other tool, they would put that in and start working, and the second tool would do most of the work then. This very place, if one zooms in to the hill on the opposite side of the valley, is visible yet the fourth style of massive stonework that belongs most likely to yet another completely separate civilization. These are not quarries this time. It is extremely likely that this is part of the huge, gigantic, complex network, vast network of underground cities that is found in parts of Europe, Africa, and Asia. And at certain locations gets laid barren when the erosion eats up the land. I have few separate videos with details about this network of stone underground cities found mainly in Turkey. A beach in Crimea could be an extremely important historic site. It's a stone quarry, a historic stone quarry in which the stones have been cut from the bedrock using a technology that far surpasses our so-called modern equipment.